just doing my thing.
Thank you to tuning into the voice of C38. All some hundred of you now.
Yeah.
Fuck.
For those of you still left with us, aloha.
I am Brendan Wyatt. That is Brian. And on the Twitch Discord channel, Austin and Colin. Say hi, guys.
Hi, guys.
Well met.
And there it is. So, how many of you would like to talk about Dallas or can remember what happened or would really like to spend much time on that game?
Still trying to drink it away.
The first Dallas or this weekend's Dallas?
I'd almost rather talk about this weekend's Dallas, but that's not sticking to somewhat of a format, which is something we've lost as well. But
we're stepping our game up, guys.
Yeah, stepping it up. Yeah.
We're going to finish on a high.
Now we sound like the front office. We're making some promises. Yeah. Just stay tuned.
We're going to do it the voice of C38 way.
That's how much we really wanted to talk about the Dallas game that happened on Wednesday.
We just didn't look good. It was annoying because we finally got to see Eigner and Nana start together. And then our defense just like sat and did nothing for the first 10 minutes and let them score twice. And that, like, now you're just pushing. Like, that puts it in a horrible situation to have those guys have their first start together and Eigner's first start all overall. It was just terrible.
Do you feel like they had a lot of opportunities or a chance to work together, or was it just really kind of everyone was on their heels and it just looked and felt bad?
It just felt bad because, like, what are you going to do? You're a team that's in last place. You go down two goals in the first 9-10 minutes of the game, and now most of your team is checked out at that point. And, like, it'd be hard even if you were doing well on the season to not, like, kind of get your heads down a little bit with two goals in 10 minutes. Like, it's just so hard to overcome. And, like, you all saw glimpses, but it just – the game overall was not very good. I don't know. Brian, you got to see it too.
Yeah, they just look so disjointed. And, I mean, I texted Brendan during the game and said, you know, it looks like a bunch of guys who haven't played together. And that's more or less what it was.
Well, and Schuberg had a bad game.
Yeah, they did. Back four had a tough night.
Yeah, we rely on him a lot. And I gave Watts a pass on his bad game and his own goal. And so I'll give Schuberg his pass on this one. But when you rely on those two all the time, and then they have a bad game, like, it just looked bad. He let a couple in. Miller had a bad game.
Yeah, they let too many balls get in behind, and that's not like them. You know, they usually keep that play in front of them, and it was just one of those things.
Is that the shift in coaches?
I don't know that, because really the
tactics.
Really, though, Cookie's message isn't a lot different from what's been going on. I mean, guys have even told that.
Well, we talked about it. He ran training and everything else just the same.
So I don't. I mean, I just think it's, you know, it's just tinkering. It's just, and really at this point of the season, you can't blame them. I mean, the old saying, you keep doing what you do and you keep getting what you're getting. So you might as well mix it up a little. But the problem with that is that guys are unfamiliar with things and people and positions and tendencies and blah, blah, blah. You know, it looked like a preseason game. How's that?
Yep.
Well, and how many times have we sat there and said this is kind of preseason to next season? It's just unfortunate that there is 2.5 months-ish of...
Unfortunately, these are televised and...
Not really playing. And yeah, exactly. We invested in it as fans, too. Right. You know, we've spent money, some of us yearly, all year, every month.
I mean, it's, you know, you can see some things going... In a good direction. Don Baggi's lighting him up. The guy's got so much confidence right now. So, I mean, there's things alike, but it's just overall it has to be a better package next season, you know.
And it was just, I guess, annoying for me is that he put in what most would consider close to what a starting offense would look like. And then he completely gutted our defense for that Dallas game. And it was like, okay, so you put us out there to what? Like,
well, and don't forget,
Dallas has a good offense, and you're letting them, you're putting in our weaker players.
I think he was putting more emphasis on the home game, because don't forget, that's 3 games in 8 days again. Towards the end of a long season, you know, yada, yada, yada.
I agree.
I mean, that's, I'll give him a little bit of a slide there.
I don't know. Colin, you got to watch that game, right?
I only could catch about the second half because I was still moving out of my apartment. But
and what did you see in the second half?
In his van down by the river.
The physical embodiment of disappointment. It just looked awful.
Oh, so it was a great way to finish off a movie.
That wasn't willing to play. I mean, outside of a couple of players and a couple of moments, it was just we were seeing 9 guys standing around the field.
Yeah, agreed. And I don't even think Howard had his best game either.
No.
So,
no.
Okay, well, how about a positive change of conversation? Let's talk about Montreal.
Montreal.
Weirdest game I've seen in a long time.
And I suppose when I mean positive, I meant just the result, the 3 points, the win for those of us that were there.
That game outside of just the fact that we won.
Eigner's goal.
Eigner really showed how much of a freaking offensive threat he can be. I mean, he read that perfectly.
It's a pretty.
And Williams kind of overshot that, and yet somehow Eigner still managed to take a look at that, reset, and then head it in. It was beautiful.
Williams played it behind him. Any other player on our team,
other than
that, would have just gone
the retired number 9.
Yeah, Doyle, which we'll talk about. Yeah,
actually, I don't think Doyle would have gotten to that. He's not exactly blasphemous. Known for stepping back.
How dare you?
He'd dive forward. I don't know if he's got that ability to stop and pull back. Eigner just stopped, pulled back, and headed that perfectly to the corner. And that was just amazing.
We can
just
agree to amazing goal. It was a good goal. We'll agree to disagree, but.
I need a drop for agree to disagree.
But, well, and look, oh my God, how many freaking cards?
My bad.
2 reds in the first half.
You know, the other thing that kind of shocks me about that game, and I'm just going to put it out there before I forget about it. I am surprised at the lack of Skeltsen-Gashi. Something is going on there, and I don't know what.
I bet the guy feels like this is not what he signed up for.
I would not be surprised. Because he's... The last few weeks, he's been, you know, he picks up little niggling things here and there during the week, and he'll pretty much tell, you know, the staff, hey, I'm good, hey, I'm not. He just doesn't have that same, I mean, he looks like he's ready to go, but he's pissed off he's not out there. I mean, if he's making the 18 and doesn't get in the match, wow, what does that tell you?
It tells me DeFont had to be pulled out at halftime.
Yeah, well, that's a. I mean, we've all talked about DeFont and where he belongs, and
that's what out of.
And see, some people
had half of his games where he came out at halftime.
I'll give a little credit to Burgundy Wave here, because some people thought that he was pulled because he got kneed in the ribs and there was an injury there, but no, he was pulled for tactical reasons.
Yeah, they had to pull Marlon back in there,
You know, it does make you, we can talk more about it with the upcoming game this weekend, but with Mikhail being gone.
Yeah.
Uh-oh.
Did you ever think you'd say that?
DeFont belongs in USL or the damn trash can.
Oh, that is harsh.
Damn, man.
Jesus, what are you, an RSL fan?
You get a 5-second mute.
Yeah, put him on.
Well, here's the problem with him. He basically has zero upside. Like, he's not like, when you see Williams over there, it's usually where we're trading off. He's good at going forward and getting crosses off, kind of stumbles a little bit on defense, but you're getting the positive of that swing up. DeFont, you're literally getting nothing out of. He's not going forward and doing anything, and he's constantly causing us problems on that back line.
Hey, let's not point fingers.
His positioning is, I mean, I said it at the last game. I felt like watching him was like playing against guys that we would play against on Sunday.
Let me ask this. Would you rather would you rather have Dennis Castillo back and playing that position?
Yeah.
Yes.
Oh, yeah.
I agree. I agree.
Bring Dennis back. Bring Dennis back.
I love Dennis.
I'd rather see Richard Terry back there.
Who?
Richard Terry. Little dick.
Dude at the tailgate.
Don't know him.
That's because you're not out of the tailgate.
Exactly.
Yeah.
All right, I'd actually kind of like to ask you guys something here. What did you think of Watts' red card?
Definite card, not sure about the color.
Yeah,
that's the way I felt. Down like that, too.
Yeah.
I think Maxwell said it was a straight red and it should have been a red or something, but I don't know. That's early in the game for that, and yeah. I don't feel that he went in maliciously to do it, and he didn't have any other fouls really led to it. It wasn't retaliation.
Well, and you see guys scissor their legs and don't get a red when he didn't do that. You know, you see him pull them together, and I don't know. I think Jared's getting a bit of a reputation, maybe amongst officials, for being a bit.
The Rapids in general have that reputation.
Out of control.
Well, the Rapids for sure have had the reputation. And I feel like in a way Axel has as well. And maybe Jared too, to an extent, but I didn't see it happen. I guess I was yelling at my mom or something. I don't really remember, but I mean the second one, the Montreal one, everyone upstairs was just going, what the fuck? Like no one knew what happened or really why, but
yeah, well, it's because it was kind of off the ball.
Yeah, it would just.
I mean, kudos to the
VAR.
To find it, you know. That was, you know, it was dirty and cheap, off the ball.
Well, crack. And when you know that he already gave the one to us early, that refs usually look for a way to kind of even up a game as much as they shouldn't. Just like a PK. If they give a PK to somebody, they look for that opportunity to give that PK back.
Unless they're a Sunday league ref and they're just fucking with you.
Yeah.
It's a whole different story.
Speaking of PKs, man, that defensive play by Marlon was solid. He had to time that perfectly, and he did.
Marley makes you comfortable and when he's on the field, it doesn't matter what position he's in, whether it's right back or right mid, or you could probably put him at striker. No matter where you're putting him, you're like, I like this guy.
Yeah.
I like what he's going to do. He's going to bring something to the game, whether it's defensively or offensively. And, we got to make sure we keep that guy around.
Yeah, I'm thinking his agent's just wringing his hands.
And seeing as we're not supposed to be so agent, you know, controlled, we got to try to keep that guy around. But anyway.
Speaking of strikers, that Baji to Gordon.
Right.
That Baji ball was flawless. Like, I was literally sitting there complaining about Gordon coming into the game. And he scores that goal. And I was like, yeah, but he basically got handed a goal. Watts could have put that in.
Well, remember.
Well, Watts tried to hand him a goal last week.
Yeah, and he didn't put it away.
Let me ask you this then about like Baji, because he does lead the team with goals and assists. Are you guys surprised now? Or as surprised as you were before? Or is it starting to make sense? Are you seeing it?
Because he plays as a lone striker, doesn't surprise me.
But he's on both sides, goals and assists.
Yeah, I know. I'm just saying. You know, he's the tip of the spear, you know.
Sense to me.
That's also a lot to do with the lack of production overall for the team, though. Like, if you look at it, and I'm not saying Baji's not a good player, but again, I had Maxwell look up the stats. There are 17 players just at a quick glance that have better stats than that in the league. So if you're looking at a player who is your leading goal scorer and leading assist guy, and he's not keeping up with these other players, like he's both, and he's not keeping up with these other players. So that that is disappointment for the Raptors.
He's pissing on his accomplishments, but yeah, he's totally pissing on his...
So who are you blaming that on?
I'm not blaming on Baji. I think that we have some strikers that maybe need to step up their game. One of them now is retired.
Step the game up!
Gashi hasn't been playing, or when he has been playing, hasn't really been performing. Gordon had his opportunities early on. Granted, he's had 3 game-winning goals.
Our other strikers in Charlotte.
Overall, he had a lot of those games where he was starting and wasn't producing. There's a lot of players that should be out-producing Baji, and Baji's out-producing them, which is great for us because Baji's doing really well. But where is these other players we're paying hefty money for, and why aren't they producing more?
Way to spend 3 minutes answering the question that you're still not surprised.
I think we've seen improvement from Baji all season, but I think his stats would be even better if we had him up front playing with someone, because we play our strikers on an island and we don't give them the support they need.
Okay, well, you were about 80% agreeable.
Yeah, and they have nothing. The defenses have nothing else to focus on but him, because they know nobody else behind him is going to pose a threat.
Okay, yeah, but there are other teams that can run a formation with one striker and be very successful.
Oh yeah, I agree.
Since we will be talking about him in a minute, Brian, how do you defend Doyle? Baji's been producing with this team, this offense, and Doyle was not, and he was also lone striker up there by himself.
Speed. Yeah, but the thing, the speed is one thing, absolutely. Kevin wasn't a guy that was going to take somebody one-on-one and go at him, but you also got to look, Kevin was somebody who would track back and play midfield. He'd come back to get the ball. He'd come back to help out on defense inside the defensive third. I mean, that's a lot of energy, and it's a lot of positioning that he gave up in order to help the team.
But do you think
Doyle was more physical
for a team?
I'm sorry?
When you're looking at 10 players back,
yeah,
and Doyle comes back, that takes away any opportunity for a counter or any opportunity for some of these goals that Baji has been able to put in.
Right, but how many times?
So maybe he's misplaying the position.
You're saying Doyle's misplaying? You are way off. No, that guy, he knows. I think he was being asked, because look, there were some times when he was, a lot of times this year, he's been asked to play behind that, behind that role too. I don't know.
Well, and is it a coaching thing? Most of his time was under Pablo, obviously, since Cook's been in, Baji's been up there.
Yeah.
So there's that whole factor of Pablo being hyper defensive, maybe making Doyle less production.
Well, yeah, I mean, it could be a bit of that. I mean, like Brian said, Doyle would defend, whereas Baji wouldn't. Maybe that's kind of why we didn't give Baji as much credit as Austin is trying to still do now.
I mean, they play a different game. They're two totally different players, even though they play the same striker position. Completely different players in my mind.
And I wouldn't even call Doyle a holds-up style kind of guy, but he's much more physical.
Yeah,
than Baji. He's going to stand on the ball better, yep. and his passing is going to be a bit more accurate. He's going to be less likely to turn and go unless he's already facing goal.
Right.
And what Doyle did with his head was phenomenal. Unfortunately, it's also why he has to retire.
Yeah, it's a big factor of it. I think he was
we might as well, since we're talking about him. I mean, we got to that point. Smooth transition from Montreal to Doyle's retirement. Brian, you're planning on putting something together, so why don't you chat about that?
Yeah, just a heads up, I'm gonna talk to a handful of players in the Rabbits locker room tomorrow, so I'll have that up on the Voice website here by the end of the week. But I just kind of wanted, you know, I think this team's going to miss him a lot more than people think, because I think when he came in, there was an expectation, and to an extent, the same with Eigner, is they see a guy with the pedigree that they've had and expect him to come in and be instant goal scorer. And that's not necessarily how they play or how they will play within this group. And I think, you know, I think everything from the practice field, the locker room, to a guy who could, like we said, track back and play defense, play where he needed to at any certain time, but also, you know, be the scoring threat on top of that. I think this team's really going to miss him. I hope Eigner is somebody who can step into that role somewhat.
But I actually think he'll do it better, only because I think Doyle was played out of position a lot, and Doyle really needs that Connor Cummings pairing, and he didn't get that here. I think that Doyle would have been a lot more productive if we played someone else right next to him up top and played a more the old Gary Smith style of soccer.
Yeah, or even played somebody threatening sitting in behind him, just something to make the defense concentrate on other things.
Yeah, when you can put three guys on Doyle, it makes it real easy to keep us from scoring.
Yeah,
because he doesn't have that speed. He's like, that's how Baji probably succeeds a little bit more, is like you said, he can, even when you have three people on him, if that ball takes a wrong bounce, he can beat people to that ball. Doyle probably is not going to.
Yeah.
And I love what Doyle has done, and we've talked about him since he came onto the team, on how he's been undervalued with this team, and he has, and he was used inappropriately.
But that's the thing I love about him, is that he never, you know, you never saw that in his effort or his game. He was never pouty. He was never head down. The guy was, I think he's been one of the best professionals, in quotes, that I've seen in 15 years of following and covering this team.
He was a professional.
Total professional. In every
kind
sense
of
the word.
Gashy was a little bit more that way.
Yeah.
Be honest about it. Yeah. Doyle never stopped pushing. He was always fighting. He was always pushing himself, which is probably what led to this kind of almost early retirement, is he's probably done that his entire career.
And I think the only guys on that, really on the squad now, that are at his level regarding that would be Tim and maybe somebody like Michael Azira. Who there is never a lack of.
Well, when you put it in that perspective, yeah, that's it. That you're right. The locker room's going to change.
Absolutely, it will. And I think I'm going to try and talk to, you know, some individuals, one of whom's parents listen to us. Hello, Superfan Millers. But I know who really enjoyed playing alongside that guy. So Yeah, hopefully we'll get some interesting information.
Yeah, we got to sit down with him at least once at the tailgate, amongst other interactions with him. And off the field, the guy was amazing too. He was so nice, so friendly, so approachable. He just hung out. Like when we brought him out to it was our first interview at the tailgate.
Yeah, I was going to say, how about that?
He came out, it's down. Pouring snow. We had the tent low.
We had two different tents. We had the canopy out, and then the awning from the camper, because that was, well, we had the camper on the truck. What a shit
show
that was.
And this guy is an international. He's played in the Premier League. You know, he's played at the top levels, and he just comes and
coming off of a World Cup game where he got gashed in the leg.
Yeah.
Yep.
And comes over there, bundles up with us yahoos.
On some Oxycontin, Demerol, God knows what.
Asks for a shot of Jameson. and he was so friendly even before we started the interview, because we usually try and talk to the players a little bit before if we can. And he was just so – he didn't treat you any differently. He didn't act like some superstar. He was just kind of hey, love hanging out with you guys. Can't wait. It was a great interview for all three people. Who knows, man?
Maybe that's what led to the whole, you know, if Doyle went back to the locker room, was like, it was freaking snowing. I drank whiskey and Bailey's. Interview, like, I mean, who knows? That could have been what started all of the awesome, you know, if and at one point someone did say the players talked about it and the ones that have come out have enjoyed it. So we did well in that part. And I'm glad that it's coming back as long as people are healthy and not sick or have the flu and,
don't breathe on us.
We also still want a healthy 18. So that way we can still win when teams are here. So, but yeah.
I really hope you guys that we get to see him again.
Yeah, man, go.
Yeah. What's up? Yeah. Do you guys have a favorite Doyle moment? Because if you guys want time to think on that, I do have mine ready to go.
Mine was definitely the tailgate.
Yep, it was the tailgate.
Well, maybe something from on the field then.
Mine's just interview in the hallway. It doesn't. I mean, most of it, I didn't even have my. I don't even have my recorder on. He and I just shooting the shit, and just listen to just. He'll go on and on and on and just talk about stuff, and he's a funny dude. I think what was it? One of them, I think the quote was, "I played my balls off," or "We played our balls off." God, that was funny. And we used it, I think.
Yeah, wrote it, yeah. I do remember that.
Yeah. Well, I also like, I'll tell you what, my other favorite was his press conference, his intro presser. We went back into the locker room, and I got a picture of him. They're like, okay, just do something we can take photos of. So he starts juggling the ball. You know, just random, random, goofy, weird stuff. It was just funny.
I think my favorite moment was actually from last season. He gets this amazing header into the goal and he runs up and tries to slide on his knees
and fails spectacularly.
Yep.
Just like
reeled it back in and like
face down onto the grass, but then he just gets up, looks like right at us, and he's just got the smile on his face. Like,
I still scored.
Like, you got me.
I still think that is just like the definition of Doyle to me.
And it's disappointing he's having to retire early because he has that mentality of a younger player still.
Yeah,
for sure.
Like, he's got that mentality of a person that if he was healthy and could still compete, would play for years.
Yeah, he's got an engine, man, that won't loves quit.
Kind of like Chris Henderson.
So fun.
Yeah, that's a good – that's a really good – I like that. Yeah, you're right. Hendy was like that.
Yeah, and we missed him when he left.
I did really like Doyle's goal against Seattle when he came back from his leg injury. When
that was the voice of C-38 Karma, man.
Because
yep.
Who what's his name? Sent the ball in. His countryman, the defender. Gosh.
Ledger.
Yeah, Sean St. Ledger.
I forgot about him.
And Doyle stuck that little flick of his toe and
dinky.
Coming at the near post, that was pretty.
Well, that header from almost outside the box.
His diving header was probably my favorite. The one to the corner.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That was just beautiful.
He scored some beauties, and you know everybody else made pretty awesome little videos and tributes and all that good stuff. So we're missing Matt's flavor here as far as a tribute to the guy, because he did a good one for Pablo. I'm sure he has a good one for Doyler. We'll have to.
Did you hear that? In the Rapids podcast, they were playing "Oh Danny Boy" in the background. I thought that was pretty funny. Can we get some like Flogging Molly or something to play in the back?
Rocky Road to Dublin.
I got a little something coming up at the end.
Oh, we'll see. Teaser.
And I'm really hoping, and I don't know if it'll. It sounds like, you know, we won't see him at Dick's again, even out of Jersey. But I'd love to have him.
You will.
Back out the tailgate is what I'd really want to see. I want to see him come out. And hang out with us again. I'll bring him a bottle of Jameson.
He's going to be around for a couple. He'll be around.
You know, because that's what his dad drank.
Yeah.
I remember. See?
Yep.
Yep.
Didn't his dad play Gaelic football?
Something like that.
Or played. Yeah, I think he played. I think he did. I'll be anxious to see if they do anything formal for him, you know? I mean, look, he was on the field with Richard pregame Montreal, so. And he did say he'll be around for a couple more weeks.
We cross our fingers and hope.
Yeah.
Yeah. And, well, and if nothing else, we should thank him for all the stuff he's done. He's just been amazing, obviously. So,
yeah, he's always been good to us as far as interviews and everything. He's really been super patient and open with his time. So I appreciate that. Anywho, let's get off the depressing train and
get off the depressing train of Doyle and
step it up a little bit.
Move over to the pregame, I guess. He's Dallas.
Or do we want to take care of some questions from cast and Twitter?
Do we have questions for our boys?
We have questions. Oh my god! Like, nobody told me we had questions.
What you want to know?
Pretty on a graphic and some shit.
Oh, hey.
You left me with nothing.
Zima, easy, dude. Keep it clean, brah.
All right. So first question I got is actually to do with LA Galaxy. What? Do you think we will finish above them at the end of the year?
Yes.
Right now, the way things are, we both have 29 points. We've played 31 games. They've played 32.
Yes.
All right. Well, I guess discussion's over. There we go.
Anybody else want to chime in?
I think LA's falling, and I think that the Rapids are getting a little bit of momentum. That helps us.
I'm going to predict we get 6 points out of these next three games. So
that's crazy, dog.
I know. Call me crazy. People call me worse.
That would be pretty fun. Maybe we'll get some listeners back.
We probably need to get our Albanians back, and who else?
Roy, yeah, it doesn't help that Gashi isn't playing, right?
Exactly, that's what I'm
looking for.
That hype is gone. And the Tim hype is gone.
Yeah, I wonder what happened all to all our Everton
hype
listeners.
Is gone, and we didn't get any German hype as far
honestly,
as I know.
Honestly, I'd still follow Everton. Like, yay, but, I mean, if you look at the Rapids season compared to, I mean, now Everton's just now picking up.
Yeah.
If I'm over there, I'm sorry, Rapids. You know, I mean, I could see how easily the focus would shift if you're outside of Colorado and the Rapids, especially right now with the way the season has happened. But
yeah, well, look at even on the league site, we are the Rapids are not even a mention. You know, other than when it comes for World Cup qualifier call ups, and Tim's on the list. I mean, that's about it.
We've got to be relevant.
Call
one way
or if we are spoiler at some point.
Yeah.
Hey, we've played spoiler twice now.
Yeah. And we got Dallas and we've got RSL coming up. So yeah. We'd love to watch us ruin RSL's dreams.
Oh, that'd be so nice.
Because it's happened so many times the other way around.
Yep.
Any other questions from Twitter or chat or anything like that before we start talking about this week in Dallas?
Follow on from LA Galaxy, will we beat DC United?
As far as in the standings?
Yes. They have 32 points, 32 games, 1 point per game.
Oh, yeah.
I don't know who they have left to play.
That's true, too.
They have an away game at Portland and a home game against New York Red Bulls.
They lose both those.
Yeah.
It's quite possible.
Yeah.
It is possible. Still hard. I think I'm hopeful because we're home for these two, but Dallas and RSL, outside of how good the teams are this year or not, are always hard games for us because it's basically two rivalries that we're finishing out the season with.
Keep in mind.
So you're looking at.
Keep in mind we're playing without three starters too. Watsy, Tim Howard, and Mikael Williams.
Who are they without? Acosta.
Sheet up, actually. Yeah, Kellen Acosta is going to the U.S., and their defender, Figueroa, is going to Honduras for the national team games.
Wow, Raimondo and Beckerman aren't even getting call-ups anymore?
Raimondo got one.
Oh, did he?
Yeah, he's the third.
But they'll be back by that second game is the 10th, so they'll be back by that game. We should theoretically only lose these guys.
I doubt Raimondo's going to get game time in the next two games. So
yeah,
he'll probably be ready to go for RSL right away.
Yeah.
Well, I think a lot of it depends on their first game.
Yeah, I was going to say, if we beat Panama, I don't think Tim will play in Trinidad.
Right, but if they still have to work it through.
So. Is anybody else kind of worried about the goalkeeper situation with the U.S.?
I'm absolutely
Three
terrified.
Old goalkeepers that are borderline retirement.
Not if they let the up-and-comers play.
Well, see, that's the thing is I think that Ethan Horvath needs to be a part of the squad. And right now, when you're looking at the three goalkeepers who are a part of the squad, he's not. So that's a little bad on Bruce Arena. But I don't know. We'll see because, I mean, Russia is next year. And you're right. I mean, you got three aging keepers. And, I mean, Tim can still make some fantabulous saves, but... You know, who
he can also give a little.
We need a stinker. Successor now.
Well, yeah, that's kind of what I was stuttering on was who's going to be there when he's not.
Yeah.
And I don't, you know, I mean, well, I'm sorry, Brad Guzan, but I don't think you're it.
He's not. I don't think so. I don't think he's
25 years old.
He's several years younger than Howard. And I still think Howard's playing better than him.
Homer.
Yeah, I mean, I definitely think that Horvath is should be a part of it, and even Bill Hamid, the DC guy. I mean,
that guy fell off the planet, didn't he?
Well, you know, part of it's when you play for a team that fell off the planet.
Yeah,
that's true.
Hey, could you see them ever calling up McMath?
I thought they could have, but the problem is that there's so many good goalkeepers that the United States have in and out of this league.
They'd call up Bendick before they call him up.
Oh God, you're probably right. Which can't believe you're right, but Eggplant would probably be called up before, and it's just due to playing time.
Yep, that's exactly what it is. You got to play regularly.
You know, and that's unfortunate for McMath when you're sitting behind Timmy. It doesn't really help you as far as national team stuff. But is that something McMath is sought after?
He may not even care.
I mean, he's got a decent paycheck for a backup goalkeeper, knowing what your future holds. Mm-hmm. Right, well, yeah, 2 years down the road, I mean, that's a blank canvas, man. We could sit there and speculate who should be the goalkeeper of the national team in 2 years from now, but anyone's guess is as good as the next one.
Yeah.
I mean, and that could be the same about half of the roster. We may think we know who it is, but it really could change based on injury, form, and where people are playing.
Wait, did we just transition from Dallas to the national team?
Yeah, we did, because we're totally procrastinating at Dallas.
Impressive
questions to the U.S.
Oh, team. That's right. Sorry.
Yeah, we're answering our chat questions.
Anything else from those four?
McLeod was asking if we can keep FSL out of the playoffs with a home win. To tell you the truth, I'm not sure. They're right on that line, and that line is probably going to come down to the very last game,
which is awesome.
That's how it's always come down to it.
Who do they
it's
play?
What's always last come game? Down to RSL. Our last game technically is Portland, right?
No, Seattle.
Yeah.
Seattle, my bad.
Yeah.
I knew
no,
it was
I mean,
a Cascadian.
Who's Salt Lake's last game?
Home game against Kansas City.
Ooh.
That could be interesting.
Yeah, it could be.
That might get rough.
Yeah. Well, it also depends where Kansas City. I mean, they're probably solidly in, but they aren't going to win the West, so. They may relax a little.
It would be nice if we had a little. I mean, it would be poetic justice, I guess, in a way, if we could end their hopes like they have done to us in a handful of times. Exactly. I mean, not only have they taken the Rocky Mountain Cup from us in the same game as the playoff hopes more than once, so it would be
a couple in a row.
It would be wonderful if we could offer them no toilet paper after a bad shit.
And you know they're going to have a big bunch of supporters here too for that game.
As always.
They yeah. have supporters?
Oh, yeah. They'll take over two sections.
Yeah.
Which was always why I was like, we should move the north section or we should move the supporter section for the away guys, because we, as much as we get along and don't get along, it's never good to be right next to each other.
But, we're not anymore. They're over
in
the other corner.
No, not anymore. That's why I said I always felt like it needed to be moved, but it is not an issue this year.
Yeah, it's all right. Any other questions, or do we want to move on to Dallas?
Moving on.
All right, then. That's enough silence for me to know that we're moving on. Moving on. I need a drop for moving. Moving on up.
As they say in T2 3D, and we are moving on.
Okay. So we have Dallas this weekend. Deja vu, almost. Except for it was a Wednesday game, and it was away. But anyway, it's hard to kind of, I mean, we're pretty much looking at a carbon copy of last week. I don't think much is going to change. Now, granted, we have, as Brian said, we've got a couple with Tim out, Mikhail out, and obviously Watts out. You do have to kind of think, all right, well, how do I change some things up? So I would think that, yeah, exactly. Nana would start. And then what do you do about your back four?
Hold up.
Okay.
Does Nana start? Is it Saeed and Azira back there?
There you go.
Azira is still listed as like day-to-day on the injury.
Right.
So I don't know if he'll be ready or not.
Maybe that's Iron Man. Azira's Iron Man.
Yeah. We'll know more. He's good to go. But
watch, he'll be out at the tailgate.
We haven't talked to him.
I just see Nana getting the start. He already got the start on Wednesday against Dallas. I think you're going to get to see him start and hopefully Eigner start.
There we go. Together. Okay, so is that what you want? You want Nana to start? Not hopefully, or think that tactically the best way to go? It's what you want.
Yep.
Okay.
What you want also
what you think is best tactically? Health wise, concerned, like no issues. Like if you know Mo is good,
I think so.
And Saeed or Azira is good to go, you'd rather have.
I think it's the best. I think it's still the best. I think he works with Eigner really, really well. From the small amount we got to see with him in throughout their coming off the bench together and their one start together, they still work decently well together outside of the team performing poorly.
Okay, and then what would you do about your back four?
Ooh. I kind of would put Hairston back there in place of DeFont.
Yes.
Okay, which then what do you do about your midfield spot?
I actually would go either – if Gashy's healthy, I'd go Gashy. If not, I would go Serna.
Something tells me Gashy's not going to start the rest of the season.
Aren't we going to – we're probably going to see Gat up at right, aren't we?
Well,
yeah, probably. I would say yeah, Colin. I think he's shown –
that would be my guess.
He likes him in that position.
On the right or the left?
Well, I mean, it's – 6-1 F doesn't the other. Probably the left.
Well, Eigner plays on the right.
Yeah, probably the left.
So there you go.
We saw Gat playing on the right during Montreal, didn't we?
Gat's all over the place, but yeah, the way they line up, I would think he was probably on the left.
I'm trying to think. Yeah, because Marlon was over on the right, wasn't he? To start the game. That's too much dead air space.
Yeah, anyway. We're drawing.
There goes our
missing listeners. Matt again.
We're down to 95.
Right? Damn it. Lost another listener. At least we got to the 48th minute. Oh, shit. 45th minute. Uh-oh. Okay. Anywho.
Extra time. Here we go.
We're going to win.
So I would agree with Zima, I think, with the Marlin Schuberg, Ford, Miller as a back line.
Okay, yeah, but we still haven't come to an agreement on midfielders. Or did we? With Nana and Azira.
Azira.
No.
If
now you still can drop Mo in.
Azira and Nana.
And maybe that's just how I'll write it up in my pregame, but I'm going to go ahead and say we pull another Montreal kind of situation, 2-1 win.
I think it's 2-2.
Okay.
I want to go for 2-0. Revenge.
I like a revenge match.
Two goals by Dylan Serna.
That would be a real revenge match, that'd wouldn't be it?
Awesome.
Yes. Yes. All of this.
Yep.
There's no bittersweet. That's just straight up chocolate chip and macadamia cookie sweet.
That'd be awesome.
Anyway. Austin?
I'm going to go with 3-1.
Wow.
For who?
Us. Team. well, then you got to give us who gives us the goals, because most of us can't remember the last time a 3-goal game happened.
I think you're going to see Baji with 2 and Eigner with 1.
All right, so that was it then. So Baji's going to get his 10th.
10th and 11th.
Oh.
All right. Well, good on you for saying the 11th. Anybody else think Baji will get his 10th?
I hope he does.
This season or Saturday night?
Saturday.
Saturday night.
Yeah. I can see it happening.
All right. Well, aside from Colin's hope, everybody is in agreement that Baji's going to get his 10th. So, Matt can put it out when he, advertises the podcast that the entire cast predicts Baji will get his 10th. Unless he doesn't listen.
Anymore. No pressure, Dom.
Yeah, right? No pressure, Dom. Announcements? Any of that kind of stuff as we wrap this son of a gun up?
Any tailgate guests yet?
I believe player votes are open for Defensive Player of the Year and Overall Player of the Year.
Okay,
and
where
your emails?
I was going to say, where do people go to do that?
In your emails. I believe board votes will be coming up soon, so be watching for that. That's all I've got.
Any early votes?
I know Brian had something.
Oh, no, mine's just silly at the end.
It'll
be on my outro.
The tailgate guest, stay tuned to our Twitter. So if there's going to be one, we will put it out on our Twitter. Chances are it'll be Saturday morning. Early afternoon-ish. If anything, we might know a handful of hours before the tailgate. We knew last year sometimes by Thursday, Friday, but there's been a lot of changes and things are just different. So we'll let people know and we'll try to send out some questions and stuff like that as soon as we know. We didn't get anyone in last week just because there was some stomach issues and stuff going on, and the only person available was the one we had the week before. So.
Wow.
No sense in doing the same thing twice.
I thought you had the stomach
issue. But we will still be there.
No.
Parting it up. Well, all but Brian, because,
Brian will come out apparently if there's a guest. We're not worthy.
Well, just a heads up, too. That's one of my little announcements. Don't hate on me, Rapids fans, but I am going to be working for the league this weekend. So I may have, you'll probably see my byline on some Dallas-centric articles.
Oh, he has to put a disclaimer on the fact he's got to write for the wrong guys. Oh.
I'm just saying the league will probably want something from Dallas, so it's not my fault.
Taste to my mouth.
I don't blame you, dude.
Money talks.
Yep, you got to do what you got to do when it pays the bills. And but, seeing as everything we do isn't paying any bill whatsoever.
And on that note, I want to wish Marco Cummings a wonderful weekend off. Thanks, dude.
Yeah, thanks for your case.
Thanks for the opportunity.
And thank you, Doyle, for all you did for this team.
Absolutely.
I know you probably don't listen, but thank you for all that you've done and for coming out and hanging out with us. And,
Hashtag
we really
thanks,
appreciate
Doyle.
You overall. So
I will tell you guys, not that it's a big deal. I'm not trying to blow my own horn, but I did get a message from Kevin. He said he genuinely enjoyed talking to all of us, and that includes us at the the tailgate and stuff too.
I'm sure he did not forget.
Yeah. So that was nice.
Maybe we'll get a redo and maybe even possibly, fingers crossed, next week. Not next week. This week. Saturday.
And can I just say, for all you single ladies out there, middle-aged, I want you to keep an eye on farmersonly.com for my profile.
There we go. That's awesome.
Turn-ons are rapid soccer, cycling, and Farmers Harry Potter. Only, though? Turn-offs are... what's the word I'm looking for?
Bitch?
Money-hungry snobs.
Oh, okay.
FarmersOnly.com.
That's probably good, then. That's why I could see Farmers Only.
Materialistic snob. That's a turn-off. Mm-hmm.
I like it. Farmers Only. Yes. See you guys on Saturday.